This is the day you've been waiting for. The sun is shining, the birds are singing, and you know just what you want to do.
All you want to do is ride around Saturday.
Before we even start today, I want to ask you a favor. I want to ask you to keep an open mind about what we're going to talk about on the show today. Hi, everybody. Rick Lamb here for The Horse Show. I do that every once in a while when I think people might kind of rush to judgment and kind of turn off what a guest might be saying. My guest in the first segment of our show today is Jane Savoie, who is a very successful dressage rider, an Olympian, a coach, a clinician, an author. She has videotapes out there, a mainstay on the expo circuit. I run into her all the time. And her message has really kind of morphed over the years from talking specifically about riding dressage, which is kind of her sport of choice, to the broader topic of succeeding in life, in particular, particularly in sports. What kind of a change you have to make in your thinking to be successful at that. And so we're going to talk today a little bit about that. And what we're going to come around to is a thing that she calls emotional freedom technique. And that's the part I want you to remain open about, because this is going to sound like a bunch of hocus pocus, but she has had great experience with this, and others have too. It's worth listening to for sure. Jane Savoie is my guest. A little bit later in the show, we're going to kind of go behind the scenes in the world of hunter riding and jumping with my guest Mike Nielsen, who's a former competitive hunter-jumper rider. Now he's a judge and a designer of courses, and he's going to talk a little bit about what goes into the design of these courses, and that, I think, will lend some insight, too, into these two great sports. And by the way, I want to address something I occasionally get emails about or questions about. It goes something like this. Do you ever talk about anything other than natural horsemanship or Western riding? Well, yes, we do. Today is a perfect example. A couple weeks ago, we had Jane Armour on, talked the entire hour about jumping. We talk about dressage on a regular basis. On my TV show, we're doing harness racing. And of course, an awful lot of what we cover on radio and television applies regardless of your riding or driving discipline. So check us out, thehorseshow.com, the listen page. You'll see lots of topics there. I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show, and we'll be back.
EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit Protozil.com. That's Protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention The Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention The Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
Every month, there's hands-on advice from the pros in Horse and Rider, the how-to magazine for Western riding. Call now and get 2 years for the price of one, just $24. 1-800-829-3340.
As you can imagine, I get inundated with horse magazines and books every single month. I always make time to read Horse and Rider. It is the how-to magazine for Western riding. Wouldn't do without it. Call 1-800-829-3340 and say Rick Lamb sent you.
Red Brand Fence welcomes you to visit our new online store called redbrandstore.com. There you can purchase Red Brand Fence, installation tools, and a wide selection of Red Brand clothing and accessories. Ordering is easy, and items are shipped directly to your home, including fence. There's also special offers and seasonal promotions. And for a limited time, listeners of The Horse Show can receive 10% off your first order of fence, clothing, or tools. To receive your discount, go to redbrandstore.com and enter promo code HORSESHOW10.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition. Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need. Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Imagine this, your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com, and while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
Now, back to the Horse Show with Rick Lamb.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Arizona Horse Festival and Exposition in Buckeye, Arizona. I'm Rick Lamb. This is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. And my guest for this segment of our show, and it's been far too long since I've talked to her, is Jane Savoie. Jane, nice to see you again.
Thanks. It's great to see you, too.
So you now are what we call a snowbird. You go back and forth from the North Country to the South Country.
Yep.
How is that for you?
The best of both worlds.
Yeah,
I love
kidding.
It. Not only because of the weather. I'm in Vermont in the summer and Florida in the winter. But for me, it's perfect because when I'm in Vermont, it's very rural and I can be a little bit of a hermit.
Uh-huh.
And then when I'm in Florida in the winter, there's a huge social life going on down there.
Yeah, I was gonna say, that's very social down there in Wellington.
A lot of parties, lots of things going on. And I wouldn't want to do either thing for 12 months of the year.
So are you
a party
animal? Is this something I didn't know about you?
I'm a semi-party animal.
Part hermit, part party animal.
There you go.
Okay. Well, as I'm sure many of you know, Jane has a long and illustrious career. Just hit some of the highlights, and don't be a bit modest.
Okay.
I'll know if you are.
Okay. All right. I was the reserve rider for the Olympic dressage team in 1992 for Barcelona. I have coached at the last 3 Olympic Games in Atlanta and Sydney and Athens. I've written 5 books. I've produced 8 training programs, some motivational CDs, and I'm just finishing a huge home study course. Huge. 23
great.
DVDs, 21 CDs, a manual. It is huge, and it's going to be awesome. It'll
be
out
in February. Like a 5-year course or something?
Yeah, I know. No.
What I'd like to focus on today is not so much specific riding or training advice as just how to develop this whole can-do sort of winning attitude that really I think every true champion has.
Yeah.
And you focused on that. And you help people develop, kind of get their head straight about some of this. Can we talk about maybe the top 5 suggestions you could offer in that area?
Yeah, and you absolutely hit the nail on the head. The elite athletes at the highest levels, skill for skill, they're pretty evenly matched. But it's what's going on between your ears that makes a difference. And I always tell people, you know, you need to continue to develop technique and take your riding lessons and learn how to do your shoulder in and blah, blah, blah. But if you put as much, if not more, effort, energy, time into developing the mental side of sport, your skill level and your enjoyment level, which is why we all do this in the first mm-hmm. place, would go through the roof. So I really have made quite a study of that. Whenever I do seminars, I always do the mental side, the sports psychology aspect of it all before I get into actual skill development, because it is, for me, that much of a priority. You know, it's like a smorgasbord. It's like a breakfast buffet where hopefully when you go by and you see all these sports psychology techniques or all the food on the breakfast buffet, you don't put everything on your plate, hopefully.
Right.
But you pick and choose what resonates with you.
Sure.
So that's what I offer to people, a lot of different tools and tips and techniques that they can use to enhance performance and enjoyment of their sport.
How did you learn this?
Survival. When I made the long list for the Olympic team for Barcelona, I looked at the top 12 horses and riders in the country. I could understand why the other 11 people were on that list. And I just looked at that list and I thought, I don't belong in that company. And I realized, I have some work to do here, because my own insecurities, my own lack of self-confidence made me feel like I didn't belong in that company. So I started my own research, and the book that changed my life was a book called Psychocybernetics by a plastic surgeon named Maxwell Maltz. And that wasn't one of the things I was going to talk about, but it's really an important thing. I had always been the type of person that achieved my goals through iron jaw determination, willpower. Uh-huh. That served me pretty well for most of my life, for whatever I wanted to do, go on a diet, whatever. But when it came to riding, iron jaw determination did not take care of the fact that my left toe had a life of its own and it liked to point out to the side, so it didn't help me with position problems. And it didn't help me as far as my show nerves were concerned. I still spent a lot of time in the porta-john. So I thought, I have to find another way, because it's going to be a really long road to Barcelona if I'm going to have
it. Well, it's not going to be any
fun. Yeah, really, I'm going to be in the porta-john all the time.
Short.
So what I learned from Maltz is that you can only make short-term temporary changes to your behavior, your attitude, which is what we're talking about, your skill level, when you direct your energy and effort to the part of your brain, your conscious mind. But when you direct your efforts, your energy to the part of your brain, your subconscious mind, then you can make permanent, long-lasting changes. And it's so much less effortful to do that, because you're basically changing the software in your mental computer. And you only have to do two things. You don't have to use iron jaw determination. All you have to do is use correct visualization and correct self-talk. So that's what started me, learning how to visualize vividly and in a way that helped me achieve my goals, and learning how your subconscious mind hears and believes everything you say and imagine, sees it as the goal. It's just waiting for your instructions.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong on this. What I've always heard, and I think you just said it, I'm just going to say it in different words, is the brain doesn't know the difference between an image that you put in there deliberately through self-talk or visualization and something that really has happened.
Absolutely. That's the cool
thing.
Isn't
that weird?
That is so awesome, because I try to explain to people, I'm going to give you I know I'm a dressage rider, and we tend to be technical, but I'm going to give you a real technical example here. If every day you get on your horse and you do trot to canter transitions, and you ask your horse to canter and he drops his back and he flips his head and neck up in the air and he rips the reins out of your hands, which technically in dressage terms we call a crappy canter depart.
Technical term.
Very technical. And you practice for real 10 crappy canter departs. Well, that's what you're going to get good at doing, because practice doesn't make perfect.
Perfect
practice makes perfect. And the only place you can do perfect practice is in your imagination. So if you do 10 crappy canter departs for real, and then in your mind's eye you visualize 100 soft, fluid, round, obedient canter departs, your subconscious mind cannot tell the difference between the 10 crappy ones you've done for real and the 100 beautiful ones you've done in your mind's eye. So you have to get better, because you've done 10 times as many good transitions as bad transitions.
Absolutely.
It is so cool.
Do people ever just say, I don't believe this?
I've actually never had that happen. I find that people are very hungry to learn this missing link.
Well, it's very hopeful.
And the thing is, I'm living proof. There is no reason that I should have accomplished any of the things that I've done except for using these tools. You know,
so you were doing it all the way back in 92?
I was doing it back in 88. I wanted to make an Olympic team, and I didn't have any money to buy a horse. I was smoking 3 packs of cigarettes a day. I was 25 pounds overweight. I was like a mess.
This is a great story.
I know. And so I started using these tools and techniques, and that's why now maybe you understand why I look at that list of 12 riders and I'm thinking, oh my God, I don't belong there, because I know where I came from.
From the Arizona Horse Festival and Exposition, this is the Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm talking with Jane Savoie, and when we get back, the emotional freedom technique. I'm Rick Lamb. Stay with us. Hey, everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a travel-in corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin. 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about travel-in corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com. You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. From the Arizona Horse Festival and Exposition, this is the Horse Show Live. I'm Rick Lamb. My guest is Jane Savoie. Jane, why do people live with fear, do you think?
They don't realize that there's an option. Here's the perfect example. The woman who drove me into the expo yesterday, she got bucked off a horse 5 years ago and was badly injured, and she has not ridden since. And her fear level is so huge. It is like off the charts. And she would love to ride, but she just even thinking about getting on a horse, she has the shakes. So here's one of the techniques that I use. I'll just tell you really briefly. It's called Emotional Freedom Technique, EFT. And what EFT has to do with is basically it's an energy therapy. And the discovery statement behind EFT is that the cause of all negative emotion is an imbalance or a disruption in your body's energy. And what you do to rebalance your body's energy is you repeat a reminder phrase, like for this woman, this fear of getting bucked off, while you tap on the endpoints of certain acupuncture meridians, and you rebalance your body's energy. And so I had her rate her fear level from 0 to 10, 10 being the paralyzed by her fear, 0 being neutral. And we started off, we did a round of tapping, takes 30 seconds, and she was down to a 4. I said, okay, we're going to do a second round of tapping. Another 30 seconds. She was down to, she says, well, I'm either 0 or 0.5. Somebody get me a horse.
Wow.
Yeah, it is amazing.
Well, what was she saying?
She was saying this fear of getting bucked off, this fear of getting bucked off and getting hurt, this fear. She was just repeating the same. Because the thing is, she, like most people, try to tough it out and bury the fear. Well, guess what? The fear is there. So with this technique, you recognize it. You bring it to the surface, but then you clear it out. And then I said, listen, this is a great pain control thing too. So she had this elderly lady who has slip disc, sciatica, whatever. She came into my booth and we talked about this back pain, back
pain. It's funny because you're focusing on the negative, kind of.
But you're clearing it out.
Wow.
And that's what people say, you're focusing on the negative. But the negative is there, and you're trying to bury it, and it's going to come out in different ways. It's going to come out in overeating. It's going to come out in anger. It's going to come out in other aspects of your life. So recognize that it's there. Bring it to the surface. Then clear it out with this technique, emotional freedom technique. And the inventor of this technique is a man named Gary Craig. He's a Stanford engineer and he lives in Southern California. And that's when I first got introduced to it. But I've worked with 3 different practitioners because everybody has their own little slant on it. And I wanted to sort of have an eclectic approach. And so I use a little bit of what all of them do. And I use it in my seminars and in my lectures. And I'll have 3 people stand up with different fears, fear of getting bucked off, fear of being run away with, fear of jumping, fear of horse shows. And then I have 3 people with pain, knee pain, arthritis. I had someone who had just had surgery, back pain, whatever, and just take their pain level down to that it's either non-existent or practically non-existent. But the point of this whole story is, when you say we sort of accept, well, this is the way I am, this is my personality, I said to this woman, you don't have to be victimized by this fear, by this anger, by any of it. What I want you to know is that maybe EFT is not the tool for you, but there are tools, techniques, things out there for you that you can basically, your life is a do-it-to-yourself project, and you can create your own reality. You don't have to settle for what you think has been handed to you. If you don't like where you are, change it. But you weren't born knowing how to change it. You need to learn how to change it by doing research like I did, or going, you know, to good seminars and lectures, and go to people who are already doing these things and study these things and change your life.
Do you still use those on yourself?
Every day.
Really?
Every day. Because things come up. You're in traffic and somebody cuts you off and you get really irritated.
So instead of going for the finger, you go for the two fingers.
Exactly.
And start tapping
on the points. Yeah.
It's probably a lot safer.
Even, and there's a setup phrase, even though this idiot just cut me off the road and almost caused an accident, blah, blah, blah. This anger at this idiot, and just the anger dissipates. I use it because it takes 30 seconds. Yeah. I use it on everything. I used to get the hiccups and sip water, hold my breath, whatever. Couldn't get rid of the hiccups. Mm. I get the hiccups, do one round of tapping, 30 seconds, they're gone. Usually you use your dominant hand, you use two or three fingers, you tap approximately 7 to 10 times on each point, firmly enough to get a little bounce, but not so hard to knock yourself out. You can do it on one side, but the meridians run down both sides of your body, so you could start on the right side and then move to the left side, or if I wasn't holding a microphone, I could do it on both sides at the same time. I basically just do the face points, and that works pretty well, but if I run into something that's quite stubborn with somebody, I will add the hand points, and that's usually enough.
Can you use this in sort of a preventive way if you just want to sort of maximize your performance before a competition or something like that, even though you don't have something specific you want to, negative that you want to get out? Can it be sort of an empowering?
I think that you can. For example, if you tend to be the type of person that you're going into a competition, but you tend to get distracted, and you know that about yourself, you could tap on my ability to stay focused. I'm in this cocoon of concentration as you're tapping. You balance your energy in a way that you're able to stay in your cocoon of concentration.
Wow. Because you're talking about acupuncture points, are you a believer in acupuncture? I mean, do you use it?
I have had acupuncture, and I do believe in it, but some of the points with the needles that I got hit with gave me a kind of little shock that, you know, I was tense because I was anticipating the shock. So this is much more gentle.
Oh, okay.
Just stimulating the points. But what the tapping does is it stimulates the points.
Yeah, but it has to be tied in somehow.
It is.
You're using the
meridian. It's all energy. It's the acupuncture meridians.
Well, this has been very, very interesting. We didn't really talk about 5 points, but
I know.
Don't care, because this was way more interesting than just working.
Well, we'll
list.
Have to do another one, and we can do some of the other things, because I have all kinds of other exciting things I could tell you about.
Well, you told me when you sat down, there's no way we could get through all this.
I know, when
this.
I thought 10, oh my God, we would be here for 2 hours.
Well, most people just go, well, here's number 10. You explain, I like that.
Oh, good.
And I'm sure my radio audience is going, yeah, Rick. Way to go.
Good.
And thank you so much for being
on
our show.
You're very welcome.
Your website, let's give that out.
Okay, great. It's Jane. It's www.janesavoie, and it's spelled S-A-V like Victor, O-I-E.com.
Savoie.
Savoie. Yes, it's French.
I always ask you this. I never can remember. What does Savoie mean in French?
You know what? I don't know what Savoie means, but Savoir with a R at the end instead of an E means to know.
Oh.
So well, I think
you're the great knowing one, then. My guest has been Jane Savoie. Jane, I do wish, and I do know, and I appreciate you coming today. Jane Savoie, thank you for being with us.
You're very welcome. Thanks for having me.
Coming up next, more from the Arizona Horse Festival and Exposition. My guest is Mike Nielsen. He's going to talk about judging and designing courses for Hunter Jumper Competition. This is The Horse Show Live. I'm Rick Lamb. Don't you dare go away. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. For me, Travel In Corrals makes the best portable corral system on the market, and here's why. First, the panels are easy to handle. They're 7 feet long and just 15 pounds. Anyone can set up a Travel In Corral. 6 panels make a 13-foot round pin, 8 panels make an 18-foot round pin. Second reason I'm crazy about Travel In Corrals is how these metal panels are made. They're notched and welded, and they hook together with a 4-foot steel rod. They're horse safe, thoroughly tested, and they come with a lifetime guarantee for the original owner. But hey, don't take my word for it. See for yourself. Watch an introductory video at travelincorrals.com. That's travel, the letter in, corrals.com.
You'll get the backstory on the horse people behind these highly practical portable corral panels. And if you mention me, Rick Lamb, you'll save $50 if you order. Remember, 7 feet long, 15 pounds, and a lifetime guarantee. Check them out. Travel in Corrals. Travel, the letter N, corrals.com. Fact of the matter is, nailed-on metal horseshoes are a tradition, and a lot of horses simply don't need them. Hey everybody, Rick Lamb here. Here's what I suggest. If you like the idea of barefooting your horse, go ahead and try it. But also do this. Get yourself some good all-purpose hoof boots to protect your horse's bare feet when you ride. I recommend the Simple Boot from Cavallo. Simple boots are exactly what the name implies. They're uncomplicated, easy to use, lightweight, durable. When you put them on, they stay on. With Simple Boots on your horse, you can walk, trot, canter, jump, go through water, go through mud. Whatever you're doing, the Simple Boot stays on and your horse stays comfortable. Remember, there are different stresses on your horse's bare feet when you ride him. Hoof boots are an essential part of the barefooting protocol. See the Cavallo Simple Boot in action and learn how to choose the right size at simpleboot.com. You'll also see the 5 very attractive colors available, starting at just $99.95 with free shipping. The Simple Boot from Cavallo, simpleboot.com. If you're like me, you need a pretty good reason to sit in front of a TV set these days. Hi everybody, Rick Lamb here. RFD TV is that reason. Finally, there's a network for people like you and me, people who care about the rural lifestyle, about livestock and tradition. RFD TV brings you family-friendly programming that entertains and educates and never ever offends. Every week you see the icons of country music with Ralph Emery, Crook and Chase, and Marty Stewart. You get some of the top horsemen in the world like Clinton Anderson, Chris Cox, Craig Cameron, and the Pirellis. And you get farm news and special features. Oh yeah, you get me too. So join me and the millions of other RFD TV viewers. Call your satellite or cable provider and ask for RFD TV, rural America's most important network. It's TV we can all be proud of. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com or give them a call at 615-227-9292.
Thank you for listening to The Horse Show with Rick Lamb. If you have a question, request, or comment, we want to hear from you. Our fax number is area code 602-279-0980. Or if you would like to email us, the address is lambemail@aol.com. Now, back to Rick.
Welcome back, everybody. Coming to you today from the Arizona Horse Festival and Exposition in Buckeye, Arizona, not too far from my home in North Phoenix. And I'm Rick Lamb. This is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. I'm delighted to have with me today Mike Nielsen. Mike's going to talk a little bit, take us behind the scenes in the sport of hunter and jumper competition, and talk about it from a judge's standpoint and also the standpoint of somebody who designs these courses. Mike, nice to see you.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
Talk to me about the impact of the design of a course for either a hunter course or a jumper course on that class.
Well, let me back up a little bit, because you talked a little bit to start with on the judge's aspect of it, because when a judge first comes on the ground, the course designer's been there for at least an hour and a half before him, doing his copies and then doing all the setup that is needed, so that when the judge steps, sits there, he goes up to the booth and sits down with his judge's cards. He's given a copy of the courses. Now, done in advance, usually the night before, the course designer has redone the course. If it was done for multiple days, he has to usually preset for the next day, the night before. So even though the judge gets there first thing in the morning, the course designer is usually the first one there and the last one to leave. So his day is much longer, but he does that in preparation for the next day. Because when that judge sits down, he not only has his judge's card, but he has a copy of the courses. The judge has to memorize all the courses offered that day. And we can talk about multiple courses, especially in equitation, which has to all be preset by the course designer. And those courses all have to be very clear and easy to read for the exhibitors and the judge alike, and to make sure that all the courses match that are posted as well as on the judge's table. If they don't match, and obviously you can see the problems that arise there, and the judges will mark his judge's card with the courses in advance of judging the class. The course designers also has a responsibility to make sure that the exhibitors and the judges alike have courses that are not only easy to memorize, but also so that there's no confusion. What I do is I start each course with a different first fence. And the reason is because of the mix-up that comes with another person that enters into the picture here, the back gate person. Now, the back gate person is told by the exhibitor what course he's doing. Usually, and a lot of times now, they run multiple courses together.
With the same setup. Is that what you're
exactly,
saying? They would have the same jumps out there, but different paths through them would comprise
exactly.
a different course.
That's exactly it. And not only is it different paths, but usually there's, let's just say, for example, there'll be one warm-up course, and then there'll be two rounds of hunters. And the reason they have two rounds of hunters is because the divisions that are necessitated by the USEF usually are four classes over fences and one under saddle. Well, you can't run all four classes in one day. It's against the rules. So you have to offer two each day, or you can offer one over each day. But they don't do that anymore because of the logistics of making the exhibitor there that long. They just don't want to do it. So they want to be there, get the maximum amount of their dollar. So they'll run two over fence classes and an under saddle one day, and then usually two over fences the next day. But in order to make it clear to the exhibitor and to the judge, a course designer has to offer three courses, and always I offer three separate courses. That way, if the back gate person is not correct on what you told him you're doing, or you told him the wrong course, it can be worked out by what fence he goes to. And then the judge will inform the back gate person she's wrong or you're wrong. And doing all this, it keeps the card straight.
And in that case, do they get a do-over, or are they just
no do-over? Unless we've had that happen on occasion when it's the management's fault, usually with the back gate person. But almost always, that way it's a delicate dance between the exhibitor, the judge, and the back gate person. And the course designer is involved, but what he set is almost always correct.
Yeah.
And I'll say that from a course designer standpoint, not that they're never wrong, but in this case, and in fact, I have had distances between fences I set differently than what was posted, and I've had to correct that.
What is the variation from the lowest jump to the highest jump of the courses that you've designed?
The lowest in the hunters is cross rails, and it's huge. It's huge, especially for beginner riders. And the highest at the hunter level is 4 foot. That's the highest you'll see any division. It's in what they call the regular working hunter. It's offered at 4 foot.
Oh, you're getting into jumping. Some of them are higher than that, aren't they?
In jumpers, that's different now. In jumpers, now, and everything's going to start to be in meters now. That's going to start next year.
Don't confuse me with meters. I'll have to be doing my math and all.
Exactly, and I'll clarify it, because actually our lowest jumper level is what they call 0.8 meters, which is about 2'3", 2'6", okay? And it goes to 1.60 meters, which is basically 4.95 feet in that area there. So that's a huge variation. And they used to have what they called, until this year, they called them levels. And the jumpers were at level 1, which was 3 feet, up to level 8, which was about 5 feet.
Yeah.
But now they're doing away with that, and it's going to meters, and that's the European influence.
I can see some of my, or imagine some of my listeners out there, their eyes are crossing by now. It sounds very complicated. Is it as complicated as it sounds?
It can be from the outsider. Yeah. Once you get involved into it, and that's why I always feel that kids should get involved at a level of doing hunters and what we call equitation, because that's a great level to learn how to organize your thoughts around a course. And then when you go into jumpers, it's much more involved. And you actually, in jumpers, in order to win a class, you have to do two courses at once. You do the first round and the jump-off round. And they have the tables that are required. There's one table where you continue from the first round straight into the jump-off without stopping. The second one is where you get to stop and think about your jump-off round and then continue. There is a third one where you stop and leave the ring and then come back in later for your jump-off. So,
now, the first phase in a jumping competition is... You're just trying to get through it clean, correct?
And within the time allowed.
Within the time allowed.
Right.
So that you can compete in the jump off, which is just as fast as you can go, correct?
Fastest one wins with no rails down, exactly.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Right. So that's one thing I've always loved about jumping and why it's an exciting competition to watch, because you can see the people playing it a little bit safe in the first go round, and then the second time, it's just they throw all that to the wind. And they
exactly.
Because they have to. They're going for it.
Right, right.
But the other thing I've noticed that changes, at least in the ones that I've seen, is that it's not the same course on the jump off, is it?
No, it has to be a different course. And it actually, they specify in course design that you offer fences that were not offered in the other class. Now, the course is different, but you can do some of the same fences, but they also really do want you to do some different fences.
Physically, it's the same setup. Though, right?
Correct.
It's just a different path. You may be hitting some different obstacles in there, but mean, it would be sound to me like it would be very easy to get messed up.
It is, because on your course design, you could maybe have fence 1 through 10 on a prescribed course, but in the jump off, it maybe would start at fence 11.
Yes.
It's not even offered.
You and might skip some.
And you'll go back to fence 1 and do fence 7, A, B, and then 9, 10, and like that. You know, so it's very different because you're trying to do turns and option, what we call option lines, basically to show how good you are turning. Can you turn and make this a faster course?
Right.
We try, as a course designer, I always try to give the exhibitor a chance to show how good he is in the turns and how well his horse handles.
Because if he cuts a corner a bit, he can shave some time off of his total time.
Exactly.
Isn't that what you're getting at?
That's exactly.
You're giving him an option to be able to do that, just by the way you've laid out
and
the course.
And the ones that usually take the fastest option are the winners. Yeah. In fact, I can always tell you, if I have a jump-off course up there, which is the winning ride before anybody does it. And I'll sit there sometimes through several horses knowing nobody's taken it yet. And then when I see that horse take it, and I'll yell out, good, that's the one that's going to win. And sure enough, it'll have the fastest.
Well, that takes some extra courage, doesn't it, on the part of the rider to take that gamble?
More knowledge than courage.
Really?
It does. You're right. It does take courage. But at the same time, usually a smart rider is the one that sees it. And that's what you're looking at. Because a lot of kids don't see things like that. And if they look, and they'll look on the course plan, and then they'll look out in the ring, and they'll say, you know what? There's an opening there I can take, and they'll even watch, and they'll say, huh, nobody's doing that. I'm going to give it a try. And they'll try it, and then when they win, it's like the floodgates open. All of a sudden, everybody's doing that one now.
From the Arizona Horse Festival and Exposition, this is The Horse Show Live, brought to you by Daily 72. And I, of course, am Rick Lamb. My guest is Mike Nielsen. We're talking about Hunter Jumper courses. When we get back, what constitutes a good one?
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is a copyrighted production of Lamb Chop Studios, Phoenix, Arizona. Unauthorized use is strictly prohibited.
That's music to my ears. Hi, I'm Pat Pirelli.
And I'm Linda Pirelli. If you love everything about horses, the way they look, the way they sound, even the way they smell, well, you're among friends at RFD-TV.
RFD-TV has the most horse programs of any network on television, every day, all year long.
Take Pirelli Natural Horsemanship, for example. Each week, you'll learn how you and your horse can become recreation for each other, how training can be shaped to the personality or horsenality of your horse,
and how you can reach your horsemanship goals.
RFD-TV brings you family-friendly programming that educates, entertains, and inspires. It's TV we can all be proud of.
And it's available on satellite and cable systems throughout the country. To learn more, visit rfdtv.com.
Or call 615-227-9292.
RFD-TV and Pirelli Natural Horsemanship.
We're teaming up to make life better for you and your horse.
Imagine this. Your stirrup drops 3 inches with the push of a button and locks back in place with the lift of your toe. That, my friends, is the legendary Easy Up Stirrup Extender, and it makes a huge difference in mounting your horse. Learn all about it at easyupstirrup.com. And while you're there, check out the Easy Up Stirrup Swivel. It takes the stress off your knees while riding. Easy Up Stirrup Extenders and Stirrup Swivels are available for English and Western saddles, and you can order them online at easyupstirrup.com. Come on, get out and ride again.
For 128 years, ADM Alliance Nutrition has been doing what's right for the horse. It was ADM who cut back on starch and sugar, ADM who balanced vitamins and minerals, and ADM who put forage first in horse nutrition.
Today, you can still trust ADM for the information and products you need.
Learn more about equine nutrition and ADM's premium products at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. ADM Alliance Nutrition, doing what's right for the horse.
Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Jeffers has equine blankets in a wide range of sizes and weights to fit any horse from a mini to a draft. Mention the Horse Show and get a $10 Jeffers gift card to use with a future order. That's a $10 gift card when you buy a blanket and mention the Horse Show. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975. EPM is a devastating neurologic disease that can strike anytime, anywhere. Be prepared with Protozil, the only FDA-approved top-dress EPM treatment. These alfalfa-based pellets are proven to rapidly reach therapeutic levels and are a less stressful option for you and your horse than a paste. For a limited time only, Merck Animal Health is offering a $50 Protozil rebate with proof of purchase from your veterinarian. To download the rebate, visit protozil.com.
That's protazil.com. See website for complete product safety information.
The wait is over. You can now get the audio version of Human to Horseman. 5 hours on four standard audio CDs, just $24.95. Visit thehorseshow.com to order.
The Horse Show with Rick Lamb is here every week at this time. So tell a friend.
And that, of course, is the simplest, nicest, most effective thing that you can do. If you want to help us out, just tell people about our radio and television shows. Complete details at thehorseshow.com. My guest is Mike Nielsen. We are at the Arizona Horse Festival and Exposition. We're talking about hunter jumper courses. Now, Mike, as a competitor, do you get to walk the course
before? Yes, you do. Before every jumper class, if it's a different track, say you have a different course, it's offered for walking before the class starts.
And when you say track, that's a different path
pathway
through that group of obstacles.
Exactly.
Okay. You being a course designer, talk a little bit about what makes a good course design. It's not just the one that's hardest. In fact, that can work against you, can it?
Yeah, a good course is when a course designer sets to the competition that's there at the show. That's a good course, no matter what it is.
And the level of the riders there.
That's exactly
it. So it's challenging enough, but not too challenging.
Right. That's very important nowadays, and especially since we offer jumper classes at so many different levels. If we're offering them at the 2 foot nine or 3 foot level or even lower, that those have to be fairly simple courses, but at the same time trying to steer that rider to be ready to move up. So that's the delicate balance you're trying to get there, to try to show those riders some of the things they're going to see when they get further in competition, but not the hardest things.
So you guys are kind of looking ahead to the future career of some of these riders.
Exactly.
A bit of a favor there.
And some, it's great when you see some of those ones that you know have ridden earlier in their career, or you've judged them, and then you see them competing at Grand Prix level.
Yeah.
And you know you had something to do with that, with the impact of those riders, you know.
What about the aesthetics? Because jumper courses always look so pretty, you know. They've got such a variety. They're colorful, and they've got some foliage here, and they've got what looks like a, you know, a bridge here or whatever. How do you, is that just a creative thing some people are better at than others?
Very much. When you have a course designer that is shown a stack of equipment to use for his jumper ring, especially when you're given a lot of variety, it's fun. It's a lot of fun because they leave it up, the management leaves it up to you to build whatever you want. And it's entirely up to you. And you can make combinations of one color and the next day maybe have the other material of a different color do the combination. So you can interchange colors. And it's part of the whole thing that you're trying to put it together aesthetically. And I've been told that, too. In fact, when I did one in Colorado Springs last year, the manager came down and said she was told how pretty the course looked.
Yeah.
But at
the
same time,
make you feel good.
Well, it does, because that's part of it. You don't want to have things put together that look like somebody just threw the things out in the ring.
Well, and it's also for the audience. I mean, it's a little more enjoyable for the audience to see something that's visually pleasing. Plus, you have to think so many things today are videotaped, how they're going to look on tape. So there's a lot of considerations there besides just testing the horse.
And the sponsors have a lot to do with it, because the sponsor money that puts the money up for all these events definitely wants to see their product out there in a very aesthetic way. So,
do you ever have an event, like maybe a really special event, where they just say, Mike, just tell us what you need and we'll go out and get it? Or are you always working with a group of elements that are already there?
All the facilities that I've done big time jumper courses for, I've always had all the equipment there. Always,
it's anything never, you could imagine.
Pretty much. Or if I look in their equipment shed, and when I look at all the stuff that's there, that's more than enough.
Do you ever? And I suppose time is always an issue at these. Do you ever go in and say, you know, this would be great, but God, I wish this was red, or I wish this was green. Do they ever have time to like paint something for you if you'd like them to?
The only time that happened, we were doing the 84 Olympics, and we had some 16-foot dark brown rails, and it was a triple combination, and we broke four rails the first six horses.
They couldn't see them?
I don't know what. All I know is they were smashing these things, and they were cracking them in two, and we kept running back and getting a new rail. Well, finally, they came back and said, we've run out of rails. And so we sent a couple guys back to paint some more. We didn't know, and you know what? Never broke another rail the rest of the competition.
Huh. Were they the same color?
Yeah, well, we just painted them the same color because we wound up, I don't know what they were back there. Huh. All I know is we ran back there like crazy and sent two guys back there to start painting rails because we ran out of the replacement rails. So,
yeah.
But that's the only time I've ever had that happen. I've never needed, I make do with what's given to me because
yeah.
it's usually enough material. And if they said that's, like I have had them load rails and I says, okay, what do we have in red and white? Because I'm looking for a possible triple. And they says, okay, we got this. Okay, well, I can't do the triple because there's not enough red and white. What do we have? Green and white. Okay, I'll do the triple in green and white.
When you set up a triple, which is three jumps in a row, right?
Yes.
With like what, one stride, two strides between each one?
One and or two.
Yep. And or two. Well, that actually goes to the heart of my question. Do you set them a certain number of feet apart? I mean, do you measure that? Or is it gut feeling as you walk through there? You just feel, well, this is about right? Or what? How does that work?
No, it's measured. It's measured exactly, in fact, because, in fact, there's some guidelines set out, actually by the FEI even, what works and what doesn't work in combinations, mostly because that's one area where you can get a horse hurt.
Yeah.
And so if you stay within the guidelines, you actually test the horse, not with the distances as much. And, yes, that is a test, but with the construction of how you build the fences, because there's a million different possibilities in triples, not just one and two, but vertical oxer, oxer, vertical oxer, there's all options. And so you can build that to whatever you feel, and it's a personal thing. And I use all different types of triples, and the amount of feet between each one does vary a little bit, and I actually, it depends on where the horse is coming from,
yeah.
as to how short or long I put it. But I usually try not to try to make it what we call trappy. You make it too, in other words, something the horse has a hard time getting through.
Well, that actually, philosophically, you want to walk that fine line between making it too difficult and too easy. You want the best horse, and you said this to me before we went on the air. I'm going to quote you on this.
Okay.
You want to design this to allow the best horse to show himself.
Right. That's exactly it. And that'll always happen I've always enjoyed building a course and watching a horse go through and watching him jump super good and having him come out clean. And even in a hunter course, when you build a good hunter course, and the hunter course has the aesthetics of the hunter course are the same as the jumpers. They have to look pretty. And it's done with flowers and with all kinds of equipment on walls and things in between in the construction of the fences that actually gets a horse to jump also very nicely. Because a judge will judge a hunter on how well he jumps, and if the jumps themselves encourage a horse to jump better, that's what you're looking for.
Hunters, the whole broad category of hunters, that's all judged, correct? Isn't it all in the opinion of the judge?
Subjective judging
Subjective
is what you're talking
judging.
About, yeah.
As opposed to when you get into jumpers, it's going to be time and a clean run.
Correct.
Correct. So that's objective.
Exactly.
And that's, I suppose, one of the differences between, we so often lump hunters and jumpers together as if
right.
they were one and the same, but
right.
that is one of the distinct differences between them.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So I think it's easy for people to understand an objective kind of judging. Take me behind the scenes into the judge's mind about what you look for in judging the hunter side of things.
Well, that's why I'm here, because one of the drawbacks of doing hunters is understanding the subjective side of judging. And what I tried to do was to open up a judge's card to people sitting and watching. And what I did is I actually ran five horses through a course and openly, while they were going around, explained to them what they were doing right and what they were doing wrong, and at the end, giving them a score. And that was while the horse was going around. Then what I did next is I actually turned it around and gave them each a judge's card and had the same riders ride the course. And without critiquing it, I let them judge. And then at the end, I asked them how they felt which horse should win. And I brought all five horses in. It's interesting, all of them picked the same horse, all of them. But I told them, I said, unfortunately, that horse is second. And this one over here, I felt was first. She didn't do the course as pretty as I liked because she had some flaws, but the one that I thought that was second was because she got an extra stride in the line. I said, there's several things a horse has to do. One of them, he has to get around. He has to put a certain number of strides between each fence. And he has to get the lead changes in the corner. So there's some criteria that they have to follow that are absolutely inflexible. And what happened with this rider, it was she did it subtly, but she did it nevertheless, and they didn't catch it. But that's the part of judging hunters that most people don't see from the outside if they don't understand it.
You as a judge, when you watch that, are you mentally counting, or do you just know instinctively when there's an extra stride where there shouldn't be?
Actually, it's funny. During the day, I'll find myself sometimes counting, and sometimes I just know they didn't do it right.
Yeah.
It's you get to see so many. You understand, we'll judge in a hunter round. When we judge a hunter ring, we'll do anywhere over 200, 250 rounds a day.
I can't imagine.
And so when we do that, you kind of get yourself zoned in without even thinking about
it.
So that can be subconscious. And sometimes I find myself going 3, 4, 5, 6, and I'll just kind of, I'll find myself counting sometimes. And I think when I'll do it is I watch a horse and say, well, she's not covering ground here, so I'll start to count. And realize she's not only not covering ground, but she's adding strides on all the lines.
Yeah.
And that's a big no-no. That puts your score right down in the 50s right away.
You, as a judge, long day like that, you're human like everybody else.
Don't ask me if I fall asleep.
No, I wasn't going to say that. Actually, I was going to say, is it better for the rider to catch you early in the day or late in the day?
No, we have to be. In fact, the exhibitors and trainers watch you. I mean, they know at the end of the day if their horse had a good round, even the last class. So you better be on. You better be on from the
first. Do they ever come up and argue with you about it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've had it happen, but nowadays we're basically protected by the USCF, by the steward. That's what the steward is there for. This is an individual that is offered to the exhibitor to come up to ask questions about anything.
Yeah.
And if it's about the judging, then the steward will come to you and ask your permission to have that person talk to you.
Yeah.
And if you can say no.
Yeah.
But if you say yes, then the steward will stand there. And if a judge's card is required to clarify what the judgment was, they will go get it and sit there with the steward in the presence of the exhibitor, because there are infractions that do that actually sometimes require further action by the licensed officials committee, especially if the exhibitor gets irate. Because we sometimes had to be protected from...
No kidding.
Yeah. I mean, not to the point...
They take it very seriously, it sounds like.
Oh, it's money involved, I think, is what's gotten involved here.
I would think that somebody... To me, the right attitude on that was, help me learn from what I did wrong. I don't understand what I did wrong.
Right.
Explain it to me, because I want to learn. Right. My guest has been Mike Nielsen. Mike, thanks so much for being with us today.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Jay.
And there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you maintained an open mind for our program today, and especially about what Jane talked about, emotional freedom technique. Jane's website, of course, janesavoie.com, janesavoie.com. And, of course, she has all kinds of stuff there about dressage and about, sports psychology and all the stuff that she's interested in. Special thanks also to Mike Nielsen for joining us today and to Daily 72 for sponsoring our expo tour this year. And I don't want to forget the Arizona Horse Festival and Exposition, their first year to put this great event on and very close to my hometown of Phoenix in Buckeye, Arizona. Remember my website, thehorseshow.com, and our show on RFD TV. Have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Lamb.